You know, we were listening to that historical talk, and it reminded me of a conference I had gone to for the International Society of Pituitary Surgeons in Montreal, where Jules Hardy was, and he was honored, and he's one of the major names in pituitary surgery, particularly recognizing microadenomas. And I learned, and I got this nice tie there, and I learned that, you know, things have changed, some things have not. I think, you know, endoscope, microscope, we can debate that all we want. But the one thing I really learned was that people have gotten really taller and since that time, because look how short this tie is. And I really can't tie it, so it must have been much shorter back then. What's the major difference from then and now? So going forward, let's talk a little bit about craniopharyngiomas. And any of you who know who've dealt with craniopharyngiomas know how challenging of a disease this is. And while we call it a benign tumor, it really does not behave as benign as we'd like. So I'm going to talk about multimodality therapy for craniopharyngiomas. I do not have disclosures, but I do think somebody in Massachusetts may. So, and I'm a Patriots fan. So, craniopharyngiomas, as you know, may arise from the nasopharynx up to the third ventricle. Most are cellular or supercellular, and they can grow into the retrochiasmal space. And they typically cause a combination of endocrinopathy, visual loss, headache, and even can cause hydrocephalus. And they have somewhat of a varied presentation depending on the age range and the length of duration of symptoms. And I think of major note, even back in the 20s and 30s, Harvey Cushing noted that this is certainly one of the most formidable of intracranial tumors. So with that, I'd like to approach this from initially a historical perspective, and then talk about the extended endonasal approach and a couple of transcranial approaches. I want to spend a little bit of time discussing the management of hydrocephalus, and then also the management of cystic recurrence of craniopharyngiomas, touch upon radiation therapy for this, and one or two brief slides on medication, medical management options that we have right now. So craniopharyngiomas are account for about 2 to 4% of primary brain tumors, depending on the age range. There are about 10 to 15% of cellular and supercellular tumors. And there's a bimodal age distribution, one in the pediatric age range and then later on in life. They're the most common non-glial neoplasm in patients that are 20 years old. And in children, they're the most common cellular and supercellular tumor. There's two main subtypes, and I think Dr. Issa will correct me and say there's probably many more, but there's the adamantinomatous type, which Dr. Takasumi showed, occurs more in younger age, often more calcified, more invasive, can be more cystic, a little bit more aggressive. And then there's the papillary subtype, occurs in older patients, a little bit less common, rarely calcified, and typically less invasive. And we'll touch base upon that a little bit later. The history is kind of interesting because craniopharyngioma, as opposed to, say, meningiomas, really wasn't recognized, and even the name wasn't recognized well until partway into the last century. So Zenker was probably the first in 1857 to figure out that there was a cystic supercellular mass with cholesterol crystals, and he was probably the first to characterize it. And Lushka identified the squamous cell rests in the infundibulum region, which is part of the pathophysiology of development of craniopharyngiomas. Ertheim was probably the first to truly accurately characterize the histopathological findings of a craniopharyngioma. And for a long time, they were called Ertheim tumors. And the first person to actually resect a craniopharyngioma or an Ertheim tumor was A.E. Halsted back in 1909. And he actually did it with the transsphenoidal approach without microscopes or endoscopes, just a headlight. And later on, though, there's all sorts of terminology that was used. And Frazier, in a paper in 1931, quoted the term craniopharyngioma. And then Cushing, when he wrote a seminal book called Intracranial Tumors, referred to them as craniopharyngiomas. And from that point on, the name just stuck. So I had the opportunity to review the literature from the advent of the first operation for craniopharyngioma all the way until 2012. And looking at, number one, operative mortality, and number two, extent of resection. And this is a chart. Initially, in the early 1900s through the 1930s, not in Harvey Cushing's hands, the average mortality So people dying from surgery was 70 to 75%, which was quite significant in any series. And that was certainly more than the 50% mortality for just transfemoral surgery. In Harvey Cushing's series, and published in that book, Intracranial Tumors, his mortality rate was 15%. Around that time was when penicillin, which was introduced in the early 1940s, and the mortality rate hovered around 30%. After the advent of, or after the administration of corticosteroids, we saw a significant improvement in mortality down to 20%, but it was only with relatively modern imaging with CTs and followed by MRIs was when we were able to get a lot more appreciation of the anatomy and bring that mortality rate below 10%. And most contemporary series have the mortality rate somewhere between 1 and 3%. And it does show a lot about how we've become very dependent on technology to allow us to perform safe surgery. And as far as the extent of resection goes, this is actually quite interesting because, you know, for a while it was thought that you must go after every single last cell of this, and the philosophies have swung a lot. In the 1900s to 1930s, there was very little extent of resection. The average has increased to about 50% of cases in the 40s and 50s. This was when the operative microscope was introduced. In the 60s to 70s, actually, the average had dropped to about 30% again. And in contemporary series, it's up to about 70%. And now the most interesting thing is, if you look at two relatively contemporary articles to themselves in the 1990s, or 1980s, 1990s, one was from UCSF and Charlie Wilson, and the other was from Ghazi Yassergil in Arkansas, or actually back then he was in Switzerland. The interesting finding was that Charlie Wilson, so this was with a transphenoidal approach, Charlie Wilson was able to obtain a 10% gross total resection and had a 3% mortality. And Ghazi Yassergil was able to obtain a 90% gross total resection, but at a cost of 17% mortality and significantly worse complications. So even back then, there was still a dichotomy as to how to approach this, but there was definitely a recognition that the more aggressive you are, there's definitely an association with higher complications. Rick Komotar published a nice meta-analysis studying a total of 88 studies and over 3,000 patients, and they were comparing the endoscope to the microscope in their comparison. They found that the endoscopic approach had a significantly higher gross total resection rate and a significantly higher visual improvement rate, 56% versus 33%. However, that was comparing the endoscope, to the microscope. However, when they were comparing the transphenoidal microscopic approach to the endoscope, there were similar outcomes. There was a higher CSF leak rate, about 18% in the endonasal approach, versus 2.6% in the transcranial approach. And interestingly, there was an 8.5% seizure rate with the transcranial approach. And then take that another step further. This was a series published out of Pittsburgh where they're known to do many endoscopic operations. And this is probably the largest single series endoscopic series for craniopharyngiomas, following 64 patients. And they noted a 38% gross total resection and a 34% additional near total resection for these patients, so much lower than the averages that we've been seeing. And this is in the best of hands. And they found that on average, they had 32% worsening in hormonal function, 20% improvement. In patients who had normal endocrine function, they had a 60% worsening of endocrine function and a 50% incidence of DI. Their CSF leak rate overall was 23%, but in the latter half was about 10.6%, accounting for their learning curve, and they had an 8% meningitis rate. No worsening of vision and no mortality. And so it just goes to show that even in the best of hands, surgeons are starting to recognize that really you just want to go for a safe resection, not try to get every single last cell, because we just know that the rate of complication is very high. As far as reaching the tumor, there's so many different options that exist. They include the subfrontal approach, terional approach, transcolosal approach going through the inner hemispheric fissure, transventricular approach when there's a significant amount of hydrocephalus, or the transphenoidal approach, or the extended transphenoidal approach to be exact. And really there's some considerations to be made as to which approach you should choose to get to that area. And I'll just simplify this to transcranial approaches and endonasal approaches because they seem to have the biggest dichotomy. The things you want to take into consideration are the pituitary hormonal status. So do these patients have panhypopituitarism with DI, or are they maybe just have some subtle hormonal dysfunctions, or they're normal? What's the status of their vision, and more importantly, where is the optic chiasm? Is the optic chiasm in front of the tumor, so is it prefixed, or is it behind the tumor or pushed upwards or postfixed? Because that certainly can affect your visualization both with an endonasal approach or the transcranial approach. Is there hydrocephalus? And have there been any prior treatments? Has there already been an endonasal approach, and is that going to be all scarred in, and maybe you want to do a transcranial approach? And has there been radiation and the vessels are affected? So in our practice, we typically separate things again, endonasal or supraorbital, sometimes larger approaches, rarely approaches like COZ or other skull-based approaches. So for this tumor, this is a patient with a craniopharyngioma. You can see on the sagittal view that the optic chiasm is prefixed. The tumor is behind it and is sitting on top of the pituitary gland. And so this would be the ideal approach, and you can see that makes sense as far as the view that you'd want to be able to see most of this tumor. And so this patient, and most patients like him, undergo a endonasal extended approach. And Dr. Griffiths did a great job discussing the nasal septal flap as a way to close the large CSF defect, a large dural defect and CSF leak that we encounter. We really want to get a wide planar exposure, identify the circular sinus, and control the bleeding in that area. And we're essentially working underneath the optic chiasm. And I'll discuss this anatomy in the next slide, but you want to make sure that you're working with sharp dissection, identifying the important structures, including the superior hypophyseal arteries, and identifying the infundibulum, the normal pituitary gland, the optic chiasm tracts, and the other neurological structures. And also, you need to know when to stop. You need to know that the hypothalamus is very sensitive, and while we can't really quantitate its effects, I'll have a slide on exactly what can happen if you do damage the hypothalamus. So this is our setup. You've seen this already today. This is a nice view of the optic chiasm, and you can see these two arteries coming off the carotid arteries going towards the infundibulum. Now, what's harder to appreciate is that there is a branch coming up. There's a few branches coming up towards the optic nerve and also supplying the optic chiasm. So if one were to just sacrifice one of these vessels, say you want to free up the infundibulum, you can actually induce blindness, monocular blindness on the ipsilateral side because some of the vascular supply to the optic nerve comes directly from these superior hypophyseal branches. So we take extra care to identify and preserve these vessels when possible in surgery. And this is an example of a sharp dissection in the area, taking care to very gently move the tumor around these vessels and free them up so that we can get good resection. And this patient had what we thought was a gross total, or mostly gross total resection. There was a small amount of residual seen on the MRI, which was treated with stereotactic radiotherapy. And 8 years later, the patient remains recurrence-free. This patient was a little bit different. This patient already had pituitary dysfunction. And you can see that the tumor was actually sitting in line with the infundibulum. So the infundibulum was significantly involved by the tumor. And what we see here is a video of the exposure. You see the cella, the carotid arteries are on both sides. And as we start to dissect, we're able to identify the tumor, the planes between the optic chiasm. We've preserved the superior hypophyseal vessels. And we're dissecting the tumor off as best as we can. And here's the infundibulum. And we are deliberately transecting the infundibulum. And the reason for this is twofold. Number one, the patient already has a component of a pituitary dysfunction, and we've already counseled them on this fact. But number two, as we start to continue to manipulate the tumor, we're always causing traction onto the hypothalamus, and that traction is thought to result in hypothalamic injury. So if you know you're going to have to sacrifice the infundibulum anyway, transecting it will allow you to minimize attraction to the hypothalamus. And the reason is you don't want to create hypothalamic injury. If you remember from medical school all of these nuclei in the hypothalamus, probably the most important ones for our knowledge right now are the supra chiasmatic and the supraoptic nuclei, as well as the medial hypothalamic nuclei. The suprachiasmatic nuclei is important for circadian rhythm management. The supraoptic nuclei are nuclei that are involved in production of ADH. And the medial nuclei are important for satiety. And so one of the major complications we see in these patients, particularly in the pediatric population, is hypothalamic obesity. And these patients just don't know when to stop eating. And it's a very significant issue and can cause significant comorbidity. And it also can be seen in adults. They also have lots of circadian rhythm, so they're sleepy throughout the day. They just seem obulic. They can ultimately have cognitive dysfunction. And a very challenging form of diabetes insipidus called adipsic diabetes insipidus. So you know with DI, the patients are thirsty and they drink, but these patients don't have the thirst signal, so they can't drink, and their sodium levels are altered. It's very, very difficult to manage. So all attempts to try to avoid this is made during this operation. Very rarely do we see some improvement of the DI when we transect the stalk, but we would just counsel the patient and tell them to continue the medication therapy. And this is that patient after surgery, and 1 year later with good tumor control. So the other approach that we like to go to the paracellar region is the eyebrow craniotomy. And this is basically a supraorbital craniotomy, and essentially it's the sweet spot of the larger pterional craniotomy. It gets you to this area very nicely, and the only areas are shaded here, just below the sphenoid wing here, just below the tuberculum here, underneath the optic nerve on the ipsilateral side, and in the cribriform valley there. Those are the only kind of blind spots, which are actually obviated with the endoscope as well when we can introduce them. But this really gets us very nicely to this region. And this is the approach. We actually incise through the eyebrow. We don't shave it. And we're able to get a relatively wide exposure. And we can reach tumors that are above the optic nerve, where otherwise the optic nerve or the chiasm would have been in our way with an endonasal approach. So this is a patient who had a surgery, an endonasal surgery. You can actually see the nasal septal flap here, and had a cystic recurrence above the chiasm, and hence the supraorbital approach made more sense. So this is the operation. We have a relatively nice view coming down this area. We're able to see the optic nerve. We're dissecting out the arachnoid in this region. And as we release this arachnoid here, we're able to start to see the tumor right behind it. And in the interest of time, I'm just going to speed this video up. We're able to identify the anterior cerebral artery, and there's the tumor right behind that area here. And we're able to drain the fluid from the area, allow that cyst to collapse, and remove as much tumor as we could safely in that region. And then we can introduce the endoscope, which gives us an angled view into the area and allows us to not only see the anatomy a little bit better, but to address pathology that was around the corner. So this multimodality approach, we're able to decrease the size of this lesion, which can later be radiated. So let's shift gears a little bit and talk about this patient. This is a six-year-old who presented with a large multicystic craniopharyngioma, but I think very notably you notice that he has obstructive hydrocephalus with transependymal flow. And that is certainly the most important immediate aspect of his care that should be treated. And whether it's with a shunt or with an external ventricular drain, some method to temporize his intracranial pressure, because that's probably what would kill him first. We want to address that. So the hydrocephalus can definitely contribute to headaches and vision loss, double vision associated with these lesions. And depending on the acuity, definitely should be treated. And ultimately, most of these patients may need a ventriculoperitoneal shunt. Only one study I saw about 10 years ago showed the ability to stent open the foramen of Monroe for this particular indication, although we've really moved away from stenting in that region. And this is an interesting patient. This is a 31-year-old woman who came to us after she had surgery, a orbitozygomatic craniotomy for her suprasellar craniopharyngioma, and she had a ventriculoperitoneal shunt. Unfortunately, that surgeon was not able to get enough tissue to make it even a diagnosis of what this lesion was. And she came to us afterwards. This was her incision, and she actually had exposed hardware shown, so we were obligated to remove the shunt, and we had to place an external ventricular drain. And then we performed an endonasal approach. It was somewhat of a tight corridor because she still wanted to have children, so we wanted to preserve her her pituitary gland. So we created a small window to get behind the pituitary gland, behind the optic chiasm, and to drain the cyst as best as possible. And interestingly, even with a small decrease in the size of the cyst, we were able to wean off the ventricular drain. We were able to radiate the lesion, and at 9 months, she has stable control of this, and she has not required any treatment for hydrocephalus since then. So her hydrocephalus was just managed by a small amount of drainage of the fluid, allowing some fluid to flow through the foramen of Monroe. This is a patient, similar approach, had drainage of his cyst, and then followed by radiation therapy with good tumor control of his cyst. So cyst management can be really challenging for these patients, particularly when these cysts tend to grow rather rapidly. Probably the mainstay of treatment is by placing an intracystic catheter into the cyst itself. The brand name is Omaya, but you can use whatever type you'd like. And essentially have a port where you can drain off the fluid directly from the cyst. So there are certain modalities that you can approach. One is to just do serial drainage of these cysts every few months, every few years, and that's certainly a very reasonable way to manage the cystic recurrence. There have been instillation of brachytherapy, so radioactive isotopes, into the cyst through this method. Also, interferon alpha has been utilized to manage cysts through the same approach. And another reasonable approach is to aspirate, get the cyst as small as possible so you have a small target, and radiate the wall or the capsule of the cyst. So serial aspiration is certainly reasonable. The issue is with long-standing catheters, there are some complications. There's a 2.5% incidence of meningitis in this series of 40 patients, and a 5% incidence of shunt of Omaya or failure requiring replacement. Moving gears to brachytherapy, interestingly, it's one of the oldest treatment forms for paracellular tumors, and Oscar Hirsch had performed brachytherapy back as early as 1912. Agents include yttrium-90 and phosphorus-32, both of which are available here in the United States. Relatively contemporary studies showed a 10-year survival of 61% with yttrium and a 10-year tumor-free survival of 70% with phosphorus. So there's certainly reasonable options if you choose to go through that route, although I think most people have moved away from those options. Intracystic interferon alpha is a reasonable option. Interferon alpha can induce apoptosis through the JAK-STAT signal cascade. It has been shown to be efficacious in squamous cell carcinoma, and craniopharyngioma sharing a lineage with squamous cells can certainly be efficacious treatment here. A study in 15 patients, three of which had cystic components, demonstrated a partial response to interferon alpha. And then a follow-up study 5 years later in 9 patients showed 7 of these 9 patients had complete response with just intracystic interferon alpha therapy at 20-month follow-up in a pediatric population. In general, it's well tolerated, but this can induce a flu-like symptom with the therapy, so the patients have to go through that, but generally well tolerated. And then as far as the fractionated radiotherapy goes, to decrease the cyst size, and you may need to continue to aspirate as the radiation takes effect, which takes about up to 5 months, according to this study from the late 80s. This one series looked at stereotactic subfractionated stereotactic radiotherapy of 17 patients receiving 30 gray in 6 fractions. They had 82% local control rate at 3 years. That was published in IJROBP. And then another study looked at 17 patients, had 6 out of 17 patients had cyst growth during the radiation itself. So it requires you to monitor them very frequently, every 2 weeks, and aspirate fluid from the Omaya reservoir while you're doing this so that the field that you've targeted doesn't change. And so this is a patient of ours who had been operated elsewhere and had an Omaya reservoir placed. And interestingly, it was just underneath his eyebrow here. And the cyst continued to grow. Every time one would aspirate it, his vision would improve, but within a few weeks, his cyst would recur. So we ended up taking him to surgery and decompressing the cyst surgically, leaving the catheter in place, allowing the cyst to collapse. We did not touch the walls, which were up against the hypothalamus. The capsule was left behind, and this area was targeted with radiation therapy, keeping a close eye on the cyst while we were radiating him. So this leads to radiation therapy for these tumors. This is a well-accepted adjunct to surgical resection. One of the larger series showed long-term outcomes with fractionated stereotactic radiotherapy with doses between 50 and 58 gray over 30 fractions. Their 10-year progression-free survival was 92%, and their 20-year progression-free survival was 88%, and their overall survival was comparable at 83 and 68%. The other aspects to this, a little bit more recent studies showed a 10-year progression-free survival in patients who had subtotal resection of 82% and just the biopsy at 83% as well. So the contemporary studies suggest that somewhere between 60 and 80% overall progression-free survival at 10 years. And this study also demonstrated similar findings. This study looked at just SRT, and they found that they had 100% progression-free survival at 5 and 10 years, but they were, and the overall survival was comparable. So moving on to medical management, and this is where very little has been done for craniopharyngioma because it's just been very tough disease to manage. Recently, there has been a study looking at the genetic mutations of adamantinomatous and papillary craniopharyngiomas, and the BRAF V600G mutation has been noted in most of the papillary craniopharyngiomas in this series. And actually, the beta-catenin gene, the CTNNB1 gene, was identified in most adamantinomatous tumors. We know that there is a drug that targets BRAF, Zelboraf, so there's certainly a possibility for this therapy for craniopharyngiomas. However, when I Googled clinicaltrials.gov and was looking for any trials looking at medical management of craniopharyngiomas, the only study I saw was yet another interferon study. This is a systemic therapy for craniopharyngioma. To date, there are no clinical trials out there yet looking at BRAF therapy or any other therapy. So there's certainly some room to work on here for the medical management of craniopharyngiomas. So to conclude, the endonasal endoscopic approach is ideal for the majority of craniopharyngiomas, and as most of them are retrochiasmal in location. Consider a supraorbital or transcranial approach for pre- or suprachiasmatic lesions, also those that are lateral to the typical transfemoral corridor. Also, take into consideration if it's a reoperation through the endonasal site or if it's been radiated and the vessels are scarred in. It's important to identify the superior hypophyseal arteries early and always avoid hypothalamic traction. And it's well recognized that subtotal removal is okay. Adjuvant radiotherapy is generally the next approach for non-cystic recurrences, and as I mentioned, for the clinical trials that are necessary. And none of this would be possible without a team approach with our ENT colleagues, our radiation oncology colleagues, our neuro-ophthalmologists, our neuropathologists, and the rest of our team that help us take care of these very challenging patients. Thank you.